Hi everyone, and welcome to this session, Writing Solved Formulas for SUSE Manager in a Test-Driven Nutshell. My name is Christian Stankovic, and I'm a Senior System Engineer at SVA, one of the biggest German IT system integrators. And today we're going to talk about SUSE Manager and Solved, Solved Formulas in general, Test-Driven Development with Test Kitchen, and how to actually port Solved Formulas from the community to SUSE Manager. Let's start with a recap. Back in 2016, SUSE Manager version 3.0 introduced SaltStack for the very first time. It was used as modern declarative configuration management that is faster in communication in comparison with a legacy management stack. It also introduced a utility called SaltCloud that can be used to deploy infrastructure on cloud services such as VMware vSphere, AWS, GCE, and so on. So, in summary, SUSE Manager integrates a full Salt Master that can be configured using the web interface of SUSE Manager. So it's basically the same workflow users already know from the legacy configuration management. So it's quite easy to adopt, as you can see on the right. Salt states can be configured on many levels. So for example, you could specify it on a system level, on a group level, or for the whole organization. It is also quite easy to bootstrap new systems, as you can see on the right. There's a simple form, and you just need to enter the host name, the password, or the SSH private key, select an activation key, and you're good to go. After a couple of minutes, the system should be manageable using the web interface of SUSE Manager. Also, the high state can be checked and set from the web interface. And beginning with SUSE Manager version 4.1, it's also possible to set recurring states. So for example, you could set the high state to be automatically applied after every 2 hours, for example. With Salt Formulas coming into picture, it is important to know that Salt Formulas are basically reusable Salt code. So usually it's code that is adjusted by setting variables called pillar. For example, there's a formula called NTP formula. And as you might already guessed, it might be used to configure the NTP time synchronization on a particular server. So for example, there's a pillar called ntp.servers, where you would set the IP address or host names of the NTP servers you wish to use. And the variable ntp.servers is used to specify whether the NTP service should be automatically started during boot time. So all you need to do is set those two variables and apply the high state on the Salt minion to configure the service on the host. Currently, there are roughly about 350 Salt formulas available from the Salt community. But SUSE also offers some formulas when you use SUSE Manager. So for example, there's a set of formulas to configure infrastructure services such as DHCP, TFTP, PIXI, or Bind. And there are also formulas to configure Grafana and Prometheus for SUSE Manager's monitoring stack. And if you're an SAP user, you can also prepare your systems for SAP HANA or NetWeaver, which is quite useful in my opinion. But how does this work from a technical perspective? So basically, the Salt formulas you can see in the web interface of SUSE Manager, so you can see in the right screenshot, they need to be stored on the hard drive of SUSE Manager server below /user/share/SUSE Manager. So you need to download the formulas to that particular directory. And afterwards, it is important to map the formula pillar to the web UI elements. So there's kind of metadata we will have a look on later that simply maps those inputs from the web interface to the particular pillar information of the Salt formula. And this drastically simplifies service deployment. You don't need to be an expert to, let's say, roll out Grafana or Prometheus. There's a formula and you can simply use it, enter some information, and you're good to go within a couple of minutes. So in this example, we selected a Salt formula about CASP. And in the next step, we're going to click on save and we'll have an overview about the pillar information for that particular Salt formula. So in this case, we're talking about CASP management settings. So we need to check whether to use an SSH agent, we need to enter a configuration directory, and so on. After we've done this, we click on Save Formula, and the next step is to simply apply the high state. And we can do this by simply clicking Apply High State. And what will happen then is that Salt Minion on the registered client system will start, and it will retrieve the information and will configure the services and configuration files as requested by the Salt Formula. Let's have a look at the folder structure. As you can see on the right, there's a directory tree of a Salt Formula. So basically, the entry point is a file called init.sls, which is the main file where Salt will define states and can also reference additional states in different files. Let's say you're going to develop a Salt Formula to run an Apache web server on multiple distributions. So for example, on OpenSUSE and CentOS, then you might want to use the map.ginger file where you could set dictionaries depending on the architecture on the distribution. So for example, you could set the package name, which differs between OpenSUSE and CentOS. If you need to copy some files to the system, there's a folder called files for it. And if you're going to have modular configuration files using Ginger 2 technology, there's a folder templates for this. And you could place your templates in that directory. Let's have a look at test-driven development with Test Kitchen as we were talking about developing a Salt Formula. So basically, let's begin with a recap. What does test-driven development mean in detail? So basically, it's an approach to write acceptance criteria before writing the actual code. This can increase the code quality as your planning is intensified. So you don't start writing code and afterwards thinking about how to do it in a nice manner. You're sitting down, you're thinking about what do you want to achieve, how to get there, and which kind of acceptance criteria is important to your use case. This also slightly increases the effort as you would need a couple more time, but it's totally worth it because it assists iterative development. So let's have a look at the picture on the right. The first step would be to simply write tests. So for example, you would write a test that checks whether Apache is installed on the server. And you could write another test that checks whether the starting page has been replaced. The next step would be to run these tests on the new systems. And these tests would fail because you're testing against the new machine that hasn't any Apache server installed and also doesn't have any default web page. So the next step would be to write the actual code that does exactly what those two tests are checking. So you would write code that installs Apache 2, maybe start the service, and you would also write code that actually replaces the starting page of Apache 2. The next step would be to have a look at the code and check whether this could be improved in a nicer way. And then you could think about additional features you'd like to implement. So for example, in the next iteration of this program or this solution, you might want to have a database because your web application wants to prompt user for information and store this information in the database. So you would write another test to check whether MariaDB is running on the server. Then you would run these tests on the systems, the test would fail, you would write the code to actually install MariaDB, and so on and so on. So it's a never-ending loop of improving your code. And this just fits perfect in the DevOps way of working. And a tool that can you assist with this kind of development approaches is Test Kitchen. So Test Kitchen is a utility that's part of the Chef Suite. It's written in Ruby, and it's an integration tool for developing and testing infrastructure code. In this example, we are focusing on Salt Stack code. There are numerous drivers for virtualization and container technology. So the default, the most time, is that you're using software like HashiCorp Vagrant in combination with a hypervisor like KVM or Oracle VirtualBox to simply spin up a set of VMs on your local development machine. So for example, you could spin up an OpenSUSE VM and CentOS VM and can run your code in these VMs. But this it's also possible to use Docker technology. So instead of spinning up VMs, you could simply start some Docker containers using Docker or Podman. And afterwards, you could simply run your code in these containers as well. But it's also possible to use Ansible, Puppet Chef, and various other configuration management tools. It also supports running unit tests within the instances. So for example, you could use InSpec or ServerSpec and so on. So it's a single tool that would deploy workloads for you, run your code, and also run unit tests in your instances. And you don't need to do this in a manual way. For this, there are several comments. They all start with kitchen, and the next would be to add a subcomment such as init, which would create an empty configuration, so kind of template. There's the list comment that would list specified instances. We'll get to that in one of the next slides. There's the create comment that would create VMs or containers. When using the converge comment, you would actually apply the SOLID code you've written in this example. Verify would run the unit tests against the instance to see whether the code has fulfilled the requirements of your unit tests. And destroy would remove the instances. And because we are all lazy and do not want to enter all these comments one after another, there's the kitchen test comment that would actually create instances, run the SOLID code in it, run the unit tests, and afterwards simply remove the instances we just created. So it's much less time consuming than running all these comments one by one. Let's have a look at an example. So the most important configuration file is a file called kitchen.yaml. It's a YAML document where you configure all the important things that are required for running the instances and the code and the unit tests. And the first thing to do is specifying a driver. So in this example, we are using Docker, as you can see. Name has been set to Docker. And we are using privileged mode. And we're also running a specific comment, the systemd binary. So what we're going to do here is we are spinning up a privileged Docker container. And the run comment is set to systemd because we need to have the SSH daemon running in the background, because Kitchen will use this mechanism to log into the instance, deploying the code, running the unit tests, and so on. And this won't work without privileged mode and without having systemd running in the background. As you can also see, I already commented out an alternative, which would be using the Wakeman driver. And we could also set the provider here. So in this case, I've been using Wakeman in combination with Oracle VirtualBox before. The next step is to define the provisioner, so the kind of configuration management logic you would like to use. In this case, we're using SOLID in solo mode. So in this container, we're going to install the SOLID minion and running it in a serverless mode. So another possibility would be to actually run a SOLID server on your development machine and linking the instance against it, but it's much simpler to run SOLID without any server. And we also set required chef to false because we do not want to have the whole chef development kit thing, because we simply want to test SOLID code. And when the container is created, all the files of your working directory are copied to the target instance, but it's also possible to set a filter, which is called SOLID copy filter in this case. So for example, we do not want to have any Git repository information to be part of the instance. And we also do not want to have any Wakeman files, which has been used previously within that particular container. The next step is to configure the verifier. So in this case, we're using a utility called InSpec. We'll get to that in the next slide. And we are using it with root permissions by leveraging sudo. After that, we also specify the platforms to use. As you see, there's already a commented outline, which points to a platform name called generic/OpenSUSE15. So that's the name of a public Vagrant box that can be downloaded from the HashiCorp Vagrant Cloud. And afterwards, I decided to go for the Docker approach. So I'm using a particular Docker image that has been crafted by the Salt community. As you can see, the driver variable points to an image setting, and that image is a Docker container called OpenSUSE Leap 15.2. So that's an OpenSUSE Leap 15 Service Pack 2 container image that also leverages Python in version 3. Whatever. And we also set the run comment here to the systemd binary because we need to have the possibility to connect via SSH. Afterwards, we need to specify suites. So this is very Salt Stack specific. What's going on here is that we are specifying the top base file. So we assign to every host in that scenario should use the demo state. And in the top.sls file, we also reference that demo state. And as you can see in the last four lines of this code, we also set some pillar for that salt formula we're going to write. So MOTD and cow type and text sounds like we are going to change the message of the day within this container. And it looks like our text will be SUSECON21, and maybe it has something to do with CowSay because we are referencing a cow type here. And if you already know the CowSay comment, you know that there's some parameter -s where you can set the cow type. But we'll get to that in one of the very next slides. So after specifying these salt stack pillar, we are also specifying the path where we can find the inspect tests, so the unit tests that our code needs to fulfill. And in this case, we have a folder called tests, and in this folder, you will find a file called demo_tests.rb. So let's talk about inspect that is used in this case for unit tests. So inspect is a framework for testing and also security auditing. It's also part of the Chef suite, and it's also written in Ruby. And the benefit of using inspect is that it's both human and machine readable code you're going to write. So it's very easy, even though you might not be a programmer, to understand what this code might do. And this is very important if you are working in a big company and you have to deal with some kind of security officers that are no developers and want to understand what you're actually doing right now. And this software also supports HashiCorp Vagrant. It also supports Microsoft Azure, AWS, GCE, and so on. It's compatible with Docker workloads, which is very good in this scenario. And it supports configuration management software such as Ansible and SaltStack. So let's have a look at the example code. So this is the unit test file we just referenced in the kitchen configuration file. We have two tests here. One is called demo01 and the second one demo02. And we're going to focus on the first one right now. So after specifying the control name demo01, we also have the title keyword, which is a short description what this unit test is going to check. So in this case, it should check whether the CowSay package is installed. And in the next three lines, we have the definition of acceptance criteria. So in this case, we are describing a package with a particular name, CowSay in this case, and it should be installed defines simply that the package with the name CowSay should be installed on the system. And even if you're not a programmer and you don't know what all these do and things mean, if you simply read the English statement, describe package, it should be installed. It's quite easy to understand that we're going to check whether a package is installed in this case. Let's focus on the second test. It has the title ETC MOTD updated. And in the next four lines, we see that we are describing a file with a particular name, etc/MOTD, and we have two acceptance criteria that needs to be fulfilled. The first one says it should exist. So actually, this file needs to be part of the system, otherwise the test would simply crash. And the second definition, its content should not, and then there's a comparison against an empty string. So it looks like this file should exist and it should not be empty, so there should be any kind of content in it to have the test pass. Okay, let's have a look how to put all this together. So we've written down the code, and the first thing we do is we run the kitchen create command. And what's going to happen is that kitchen talks to the local Docker daemon on the development system. It would pull the image from Docker Hub. It would start the container. It would start the SSH service and so on. This takes a couple of seconds. And in the next step, we are running kitchen verify. Remember, we simply created an empty container. We have not run any SolStack code in it. So it's just an empty container without any installed applications. So what happens? The unit tests will fail. The first test, demo 01, fails because we do not have a package causer installed on that machine. And for the next check, demo 02, we see that the file exists. The content is not empty. So we have some failures in that test. So we know, okay, some things are working, some things are not working. So the next step would be to actually run our salt code. To do so, we run the kitchen converge command. What will happen now is that kitchen communicates with the container via SSH, and it will actually run the salt minion in serverless mode. Previously, the salt files will also be copied to the instance, and the salt minion will simply apply those states which are defined in the salt formula. And as you can see here, for example, the causa package has been installed in a particular version using the zipper package manager version 3.03 and so on. We see we have two changes, and it also took a couple of seconds to have this task completed. Let's see what happens if we run these tests again. So we're again running the kitchen verify command. And as you can see, all our unit tests are now green. So all our acceptance criteria have been fulfilled by the code we wrote. And after that, we can simply run the kitchen destroy command in order to have the container stopped and also removed. Okay, so this is what an actual kitchen test room development process would look like in if you're working on your local development machine. But there's also a very interesting salt formula template crafted by the community that I found online on GitHub. That's basically a GitLab pipeline template. So GitLab is very commonly used if you're working in bigger teams and want to collaborate on code. And this is a CI/CD pipeline template that does linting. So it checks, for example, whether your code is best practice, whether there are things that are considered as deprecated and might be removed in future versions of Ruby or Salt. It also lints your commit messages. I didn't know that there's a linter for a Git commit message. So if you're a lazy developer and your commit message isn't that informative, then the pipeline stage will stop at that stage and will tell you, come on, the next time, maybe you should write a better and more informative commit message. And after linting the code and the commit message, it can actually run test kitchen for major Linux distributions. So there are a couple of Docker image templates you can use. For example, the OpenSUSE template we were using in the previous slides has also been crafted by that community. So there's CentOS, there's Arch, Amazon Linux, Debian, and so on and so on. And it will run a DIND, so Docker in Docker, to actually run test kitchen. That's quite good because you don't need to spin up local containers on your machine. It's simply running on your GitLab runner and you can check the output from the web interface. Quite handy. Okay, but how to actually port existing SALT formulas to SUSE Manager? We have now seen how to write actual SALT formula code, but to have it integrated in the interface of SUSE Manager, some additional steps need to be done. So there are folders per formula that are part of user share SUSE Manager formulas. There's a folder metadata and a folder states. And in these two folders, there is a folder with the name of your SALT formula. So for example, if your formula name is NTP, then you would have folders NTP in those directories. In the states folder, you would have the formula.sls files. You can simply copy them from GitHub or wherever you got this formula from. And the metadata form YAML file maps the pillar information to the UI elements. So for example, you could create an input field, a group, checkboxes, and you can also specify predefined values. In the metadata file, you would simply have a short description what this formula does and where exactly in the SUSE Manager web interface this formula is displayed. Let's start with an example. So this is a file user share SUSE Manager formulas metadata demo metadata.yaml. So we have a short description, MOTD settings. We will have the group where it can be found. In this case, it's for a system configuration or security settings. And the form.yaml files look like this. We have the name MOTD. So that's the name of the pillar. We have the type set to group so that the cow type and the text pillar are two separate variables or pillar that are part of the MOTD view. So cow type would be simply a select box. As you can see, we have dollar type set to select. So it's simply box where users can click on and they can select hyphen B, hyphen D, or hyphen S. So that's dollar values. And as you can see in dollar default, we have set the default value to hyphen S. And dollar name, simply a short description users will see when they open the view in their web browser. The next pillar we're going to show in the interface is text. And as you can see, we have set dollar type to text. So it will be a text field where the user can simply enter things. The default would be set to SUSECon 21. And we have a short description called name. And we set this to text the cow should say. And the actual SALT code looks like this. That's the init.sls file. It's not a pretty good one, but I try to figure out a very basic example that can be easy understood when seeing this presentation. So we have the first state cow say, which would leverage the SALT state's package.installed. So we will install the package called cow say. And we have a job write MOTD, and that would simply run a comment line. And we have a string here, cow say. We will place the pillar MOTD cow type, which would be hyphen S, for example. And after that, we have the actual text the user entered. So SUSECon 21, for example. And we will simply redirect that output to the file /etc/MOTD. Using this in SUSE Manager would look like this. We have a group, MOTD settings. We can select the cow type from the select box. We can enter a text. And after we save these settings and apply the hide state, we will see this output the next time we log in using SSH, for example. So we have a ASCII cow saying SUSECon 21. That's it. Here are some links to have some options for you to get started. So there's an official SALT stack formula repository available on GitHub. It's roughly about 350 formulas right now. And there's also an unofficial SALT stack formula GitHub organization, which has roughly about 180 formulas right now. I also linked the SALT stack formula template. So it's a naked SALT stack formula with the GitLab CI/CD pipeline you can simply use. And the example from this presentation is also available on GitHub. So if you want to get started and have a look and do it on your own, you can simply check out this repository and do your very first steps. Okay, thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed this talk, and I hope you will enjoy the other talks of SUSE Con 21. Thanks a lot. Take care.